Welcome to this series of videos on accessibility requirement for public procurement of ICT products and services in Europe, the EN 301549 standard. This is the fifth video. It's sponsored by Microsoft and produced by Funka. My name is Susanna Lorin. I am an accessibility expert with a long experience in standardization. In this video, we are going to look closer at the first chapter with technical requirements in the EN 301549, Chapter 5. This chapter covers generic requirements. But first, remember that this is just one part of the EN standard. You need to get familiar with all technical requirements in the standard. To get an overview of the structure of the standard, we recommend that you watch video 3 in this series. It is also a good idea to watch video 4, which covers chapter 4. This will help you understand the user needs, also called functional statements. You might ask yourself, what does generic requirements mean? In the context of EN 301549, it means requirements that might be applicable regardless of technology. These requirements can be used across different types of ICT products and services. It doesn't mean that all the requirements are always relevant, but it means that you must consider them in most situations. There are a total of 9 subsections in this chapter. 5.1 is closed functionality. 5.2 has to do with activation of accessibility features. 5.3 is biometrics. 5.4 covers the preservation of accessibility information during conversions. 5.5 has to do with operable parts. 5.6 is locking or toggle controls. 5.7 is key repeat, and 5.8 covers double strike key acceptance. In 5.9, we learn about simultaneous user actions. Chapter 5.1 contains requirements on ICT with closed functionality. That is when the user interface, or parts of the user interface, is closed so that a user cannot adjust settings and cannot install or connect personal assistive technology. Some examples of closed functionality are ATMs, ticket machines, and check-in machines at the airports. But computers where users cannot adjust settings or install assistive technology are also considered closed functionality. This is the biggest subchapter of generic requirements, and it's an important one. If you take away the ability for the user to use his or her own assistive technology, it's your responsibility to make sure that all users can access your product. When having a product with closed functionality, the interface must provide the alternatives and settings that users might need. Therefore, there are requirements on the product giving auditory output to help users that cannot see. And the other way around, there are requirements on the ICT product providing visual output as an alternative to auditory information, so that you can see the information even if you cannot hear it. Think of error messages, for example. These are usually both seen and heard, which is good, because users have varying abilities to perceive the message. The requirements of this chapter also include requirements on auditory output. That means that the ICT should provide speech or the possibility for the user to connect a personal headset. The audio provided must correlate to what is happening on the screen, so that the user understands the connection between the two. Of course, the user must be able to pause the speech or repeat it. That is, if this is not impossible because of security concerns. Alternative text descriptions of images for visually impaired users should follow the same success criterion as Web Content Accessibility Guidelines 2.0, number 1.1.1. There are also requirements on volume levels and the possibility to alter the volume. It covers requirements on the option for the user to control speech output and requirements that masked text, which means passwords, shouldn't be repeated with sound output if it's not certain that the output only is perceivable by the user. This means that if you have headphones plugged in and the output is given only in the headphones, you should be fine. since many users can have difficulties reading small text, not least outdoors in bright sunlight, it's important that the text is big enough or possible to enlarge. If the text in a device with closed functionality cannot be enlarged, the text needs to be of readable font size. In requirement 5.1.4, you have a mathematic formula specifying how big the text needs to be. Finally, there is a requirement on closed functionality saying that if the user can move focus to an element in the interface, it must also be possible to move focus away from that element, so that the user doesn't get trapped. We haven't gone in detail with every requirement here, so if your product or service have closed functionality, you should read this subchapter carefully. The intent is to provide users with the information and mechanisms they need to use the interface, regardless of their abilities. When you have closed functionality, you have to cater for the user needs, otherwise catered for by assistive technology. One important thing to keep in mind is that if you have a product with closed functionality, you need to consider the requirements of the other chapters in the standard. Chapter 5.2 has to do with activation of accessibility features. This is a short and easy to understand part of the requirements. It says that if the product or service has documented accessibility features, these must be possible to activate without relying on a method that does not support the same demand you need the accessibility feature for. This should be quite obvious. If the product or service has, for example, speech output that is necessary for one user group, that user group needs to be able to activate that feature. Chapter 5.3 has to do with biometrics. The important thing here is that users should be able to handle the product or service without the use of a specific biological characteristic. For example, the user should not be required to use a fingerprint to unlock a phone. The product or service can use biological characteristics, but there should be an alternative way of unlocking the phone. 5.4 is preservation of accessibility information during conversions. In many situations, information or communication is converted. One of the most common examples is when you convert content from one document format to another. When converting, it's important that all accessibility information is maintained. For example, headings need to be structured in the correct way for users with assistive technology. If there is a correct heading structure in the first document, this should be included also in the document you convert it into. There might be situations when the target format has less possibilities for accessibility information than the original one. In these cases, you should make sure that as much accessibility information as possible is converted. 5.5. Operable parts. When the ICT product has physical controls handled by the user, like for example a button to twist or a handle to grasp, there must be another way to fulfill the same task. This is especially important for users with motor impairments. Also, the operable parts need to be possible to find and operate for users that cannot see them. This could be done, for example, by giving tactile instructions and speech feedback. 5.6 has to do with locking or toggle controls. When a product or system has controls like checkboxes or buttons that can have different status, for example, checked or unchecked, active or deactivated, the status must be possible for the user to understand without affecting the status as such. For example, it must be possible to understand if a caps lock key is pressed or not without pressing it. In this subsection, there are two requirements. There must be tactile or auditory information for visual controls. For example, if the status of the checkbox is visual, the user must have the possibility to hear or feel the status. It must also be possible to see the status, even if it normally is non-visual. For example, if the status of the checkbox is presented by sound, it must also be possible to see. 5.7 is key repeat. Users must have the possibility to alter the delay before the key repeat to at least 2 seconds. And it must be possible to adjust the key repeat rate down to 1 character per 2 seconds. This should make it possible for users to have enough time to hear that the input is correct. 5.8 has to do with double strike key acceptance. If the product has a keyboard or keypad, the user must have the possibility to adjust the delay before it is possible to press the same key again to at least half a second. This makes it easier for users that have slower movements to avoid double inputs. The last section in this chapter, 5.9, has to do with simultaneous user actions. This is important for many users that are not used to the interaction mode of a particular device. It's also important for user groups such as persons with limited reach and users with motor impairments. The requirement states that it should be possible to use a product or service without having to do two things at the same time. It should be possible to open a device, for example a laptop, with only one hand, or it should be possible to use a touchscreen with only one finger. And the user should not be required to both speak and touch the device at the same time. The ICT can make it possible to use simultaneous actions if that is useful, but it must not force the user to it. There must be an alternative way that does not require the user to do two things at the same time. Remember, these requirements can be applicable for all ICT products and services. They do not cover everything, but they are a good starting point. No matter what you are going to procure, it makes sense to look at the requirements of Chapter 5. If you would like to know more, please have a look at our other videos. There is one video for each chapter in the EN standard. Thanks for watching.